For all updates on CAT prep, please subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon.
Hi, welcome to Bodhi Prep, and here we have a passage. Now, this passage is going to be a real difficult one. Believe me, this is not going to be an easy passage, and I think this is the sort of passage that most of the students, they dread. Because it can make things, this kind of passage can make things very, very difficult, apparently very difficult. And we always tell the students that when you start your sectional or mock test or your actual CAT, you have to look at the first paragraph of the passages and pick the one that is the easiest to read. This is the way you can select. But suppose if there is no option and all the passages are equally difficult to read, then what would you do? There is no way out except reading those passages and going ahead and attempting the questions, right? So what would you do if the passage is really difficult and all the passages are difficult and there is no option to pick and choose because everything is equally difficult? Then you have to go and read. And how would you read in that case, correct? And the biggest barrier in these passages can be vocabulary. So the reason why a passage becomes tough is not because of the writing style alone or the subject matter alone, but also because of vocabulary. So many a time, writers use very difficult words, and these words make comprehension still more difficult. And this is what we are going to see in this RC, in this passage. The idea is that, can we make some sense of this passage in spite of this difficult vocabulary, in spite of not understanding so many words? Now, if you see here on the screen, I have marked many words. And the reason I have marked many words is because I wanted to show you how many words are in this passage are difficult words. So, for example, if you look at this number here, I have put the figure 14 here. Now, 14 shows that there are 14 words in this first paragraph. And similarly, if you go to the next paragraph and the subsequent paragraph, you will find that there are more than 40 words in this RC that are not going to be easy for you to remember. So, yes, such an RC can teach you a lot about vocabulary as well. But then without worrying about these 40 words, I would try to read the RC and I would try to make some sense of what exactly is the author trying to say, right? It says literature and the Holocaust have a complicated relationship. Now, the very first sentence has a word that many of you might not be knowing. So if you haven't read history or watched movies, you will not know the meaning of the word Holocaust. So let's believe that you don't know the meaning of the word, but the author says that literature and Holocaust have a complicated relationship. Literature qua art, innately concerned with the representation and appropriation, seemingly stands opposed to the immutability of the Holocaust and our oversized obligations to its memory. Now, this sentence is not going to be easy for you to understand. Why? Because it says literature qua art. So many of us don't know the meaning. And then it says innately concerned with representation and appropriation, seemingly stands opposed to the immutability of the Holocaust and our oversized obligation to its memory. Now, what you understand from it is that literature, so this is how we make sense of sentences. Literature stands opposed to the Holocaust. This is the reason why they have a complicated relationship. So what happens is, even when you are reading complicated sentences, you can make some sense of it. How? Literature and Holocaust have a complicated relationship. Literature stands opposed to the Holocaust because of some reason we don't know. So you don't know the meaning of this phrase, you don't know the meaning of this word, you don't know the meaning of immutability. You may know, may not know, that's a different thing. But what does the author say? So if I break this down, it says literature stands opposed to the Holocaust and our oversized obligation to its memory. So no need to worry about what is oversized obligation. So okay, literature and Holocaust are not on good terms. Good literature makes artistic demands, flexes and contorts narrative. So when you are flexing narrative, that means you are making it very much flexible. It resists limpid morality, compromises reality. So what does good literature do? Good literature has this, has that. It compromises reality's details. Regarding the Holocaust, this seems unconscionable and even blasphemous. That means the Holocaust is an event in which you cannot compromise reality. Literature is all about compromising reality, whereas Holocaust is not about compromising reality. Why? Because it is Holocaust. Regarding the Holocaust, this seems unconscionable. What is unconscionable? unbearable, something that should not do. So good literature compromises reality, whereas regarding the Holocaust, this is something which we would not even think of. The horrors of Auschwitz and Buchenwald need no artistic amplification. So this Auschwitz and Buchenwald are the places where the Holocaust was done. And they don't need any artistic amplification. The memoir, the first-person unembellished account, has long been considered apotheosis of the form, confining Holocaust literature to documentation. So what is Holocaust literature? Holocaust literature is only documentation. That means there is no literature in Holocaust. In the sense that in Holocaust, you can't compromise reality. In Holocaust literature, you can't flex the narrative. You can't have any sort of artistic amplification. So good literature has all these things, but in Holocaust, you can't have these things. You can't misrepresent anything. And that's the reason why they have a complicated relationship. This is what the first para has to say. So I did not tell you the meaning of Holocaust. I did not tell you the meaning of appropriation. I did not tell you the meaning of limpid, unconscionable, blasphemous. All these words I did not discuss at all. Because the chances are that in the exam, you might come across a passage like this, and you might not know the meaning of all these words. And in spite of not knowing the meaning of all these words, you should be able to go ahead and make some sense of what exactly is going on in the passage. So, if you look at the first paragraph, without going into the meanings of the words, I have told you that the author is trying to tell us that literature and Holocaust have a complicated relationship, because literature basically means, you know, amplifying things, changing things, distorting things, whereas Holocaust is something that cannot be distorted. You can't compromise reality in Holocaust. That's why they have a complicated relationship. So once this is clear to you, it very much sets the tone of the passage. Now, many of you might wonder, how would I do this in the exam? The point is, I did not look at any word whose meaning I don't know. I simply tried to make some sense of what is going on. And that's why I picked only those words which I could make some sense of. And from that, I got to understand, okay, so literature is basically compromising detail, amplifying artistically something. Holocaust literature does not allow that to us. That's the reason why the relationship is complicated. Elie Wiesel, the personification of Holocaust remembrance, is the fiercest exponent of art's illegitimacy with respect to the Holocaust. Then, Auschwitz defeated culture, later it defeated art. He wrote, "The truth of Auschwitz remains hidden in its ashes." Theodore Adorno's famous dictum that to write poetry after Auschwitz is barbaric has been frequently invoked to criticize any artistic appropriation of the Holocaust. So, you know, again, in this paragraph, we get to know that any sort of artistic representation of the Holocaust has been criticized. So this content of this paragraph is very similar to the content of the earlier paragraph, without adding much detail apart from some of the quotes that have come from people who have criticized this. So some people say that the truth of Auschwitz remains hidden in its ashes. Any sort of artistic representation is not desirable, is barbaric, and so on and so forth. So again, you should not use literature in Holocaust. That means, as far as representing Holocaust is concerned, you have to stick to the truth without making any sort of distortion of the reality. So again, a repetition of what has come before. Too many critics, instead of assessing, parsing, and criticizing, treat Holocaust works as inviolable, beyond judgment or even approach. Such sacralization is disservice, smothering the critical dialogue that great literature engenders. Ruth Franklin's new book, A Thousand Darknesses, Lies and Truth in Holocaust Fiction, is therefore more than a towering work of criticism and insight. So now we come to the main point, that there is some person by the name Ruth, and that person has written a book, A Thousand Darknesses. And what is it? It is a towering work of criticism and insight. Franklin seeks to reclaim Holocaust literature as just that, literature about and inspired by the Holocaust. So Franklin's attitude towards Holocaust literature is literature about, inspired by Holocaust. We don't know whether Franklin is also in the same category of people who say that Holocaust literature should not be distorted or not. So let's see what Franklin has to say, and that will become clear in the next paragraph. The memoir's primacy over standard literature is misguided for two overlapping reasons. First, the distinction between the two is deceivingly small. So the memoir is basically, so what is a memoir? A memoir is a documentation. So for example, you experience something and you simply document it. That is known as memoir. And what is literature? Literature is basically having some sort of colorful distortion. not for the sake of distorting reality, but for the sake of making it more appealing to people. So the memoir's primacy over standard literature is misguided for two overlapping reasons. First, the distinction between the two is deceivingly small. So author says that memoir and literature are almost similar. There's not much of a difference. And the second, their respective functions are aligned. Franklin devotes each chapter to a major Holocaust work, from Wiesel's Night to Thomas Kenley Schindler's List. So what happens is, Franklin in her book is devoting chapters to basically Holocaust work. So what is happening? Franklin is writing a book in which the chapters are dedicated to the works of Holocaust by writers. So Wiesel's Night, from Wiesel's Night, this is a book which has been included in Franklin's book. Or this book's criticism has been included in Franklin's book. And even Schindler's List's book has been included in Franklin's discussion. Repeatedly demonstrating just how slippery and arbitrary the division between the fact and fiction is. Because the memoir as unfiltered actuality is a myth, Franklin illustrates how many exemplary Holocaust works dance between genres and are no less valuable for it. So what does Franklin say? Franklin says that there are many exemplary works that dance between genre. Some are literature, some are memoir, some are this, some are that. But they are no less valuable for. They are equally valuable. That means that Franklin believes that you should not try to unnecessarily say that Holocaust literature has to be purely a memoir. It can be literature as well, and it can be equally valuable. Jacob Littner's, I don't know what this word means, is a book originally believed to be fiction and later discovered to be based on fact. Its history is a dizzying stream of authorships, ghost authorships, translations, and so on. So there is one more book which has been discussed by Franklin in her book. Literature is supplementary, not antithetical to history. So again, it's a very, very important statement. Literature is supplementary basically means what? Literature is adding, not antithetical to history. So if you look at history, then literature is supplementary means literature adds to history, not opposite to history. That is what we mean by antithesis or antithetical. It allows and in the best instances demands readers to universalize, empathize, to visualize, not merely be informed. So literature is supplementary to history, not against it. Testimony is critical, of course, as are scholarship and personal histories. The Holocaust is one of the most thoroughly documented events in history and still entirely resists comprehension. The unadorned facts and uninflected history are almost unbearably distressing. Viewing images of stacked corpses or skimming meticulously organized lists. So what do you get from this? From this, you get to know that the Holocaust is basically about killing of people. And that's the reason why the author believes that at the start of the paragraph, many people believe that Holocaust should not be distorted. It should basically match reality. And then the author goes on to say that there is a writer by the name Franklin, Ruth Franklin, and she has done that. Literature, though, affects us in ways that even the most brutal history cannot. It vivifies and propels an event. Vivifies means to give life to something. Propel means to give a boost to something. It vivifies and propels an event, however geographically, temporally, and psychologically removed towards the personal and immediate. Literature is an emotional chronicle, a history of the intangible, a quest to impart sentiment. Conveyance of the Holocaust is an impossible but necessarily appeal to our imagination. And literature is the pathos to history's logos. For the role of Holocaust literature, the eternal role of literature, period, is to make it new again, to make it real, to make it felt. Now, what is the point here? Now, if you read this passage, many of you would not go beyond, let's say, the first paragraph and say, my God, what's going on here? It's so difficult to understand. And difficult indeed it is. I don't deny that. But the point is that suppose if you come across a passage in which you have to read this thing because there is no other way out, what would you do? You have to show the guts that let's read it first. Let's not come to the conclusion that I don't understand because you have no other option. Everything is tough. Then you have to read this. And after reading this, you realize that there are two terms that are frequently discussed in the passage. The first term is Holocaust. The second term is literature. And the author says that literature and Holocaust have a complicated relationship. Why? Because there are people who believe that Holocaust should not be distorted. Its reality should be as it is. Whereas literature is all about, you know, adding something to it, adding flavor, adding something so that it appeals to the audience. And what happens in the later half is there is a critique, Ruth Franklin, and what he has done. She has, Ruth, whatever her, this person, Ruth Franklin, has actually written a book in which this person goes through all the literature of Holocaust. And then finally, Towards the end, the author and both Ruth believe that you cannot keep literature out of Holocaust. I mean, you can't say that literature should not be Holocaust event should not be used in literature, or we should not have literature based on Holocaust event. That's why he says the memoirs primacy overstand literature. So everyone wants that whatever we have about the Holocaust should be a memoir. What is a memoir? A pure documentation of the events without any literary touch to it. But the author says, and even Franklin also agrees with that, that the memoirs and the standard literature, the gap between them is deceivingly small. And then from that, we also get to know that Franklin illustrates how many exemplary Holocaust works they dance between genre. Some are memoirs, some are literature, some are this, some are, but they are still no less valuable for it. That means they are equally valuable. That means you can have Holocaust in different genres and they can all be equally valuable. And then in the last two paragraphs, both the author and also to some extent Franklin, they talk positively about literature. That literature is supplementary, not antithetical to history. So if something has happened in history, then literature will definitely add value to it. And that's the reason why people who think that Holocaust should always be in the form of memoir and should not be used or misrepresented are basically wrong. Why? Because literature definitely makes things more appealing. And Holocaust as an event can definitely become a part of literature, though many people believe that it should not happen. So these are the two words, literature versus Holocaust. Many people believe that Holocaust events should be the way they are without any kind of tampering. But the author believes, and even Ruth Franklin believe, that yes, Holocaust can be a part of literature in which you can put things in a certain perspective to bring the truth in front of the audience. That is what they are discussing actually. So it's a very, very difficult RC. Most of you would really lose yourself in this kind of RC. But then if you know a bit of history, if you have watched movies on the Holocaust, and if you are familiar with this kind of language, I think you would be able to make some sense of it. It's quite possible that once you have understood the central idea, it might become possible for you to crack all the questions just because you have understood the central idea of the passage.